I wasn't supposed to start for like 4 more minutes, but I decided to start it so people will get in here and won't miss the hype Dark Souls ASMR action. And I put the reverb on because I thought it's very atmospheric for this type of deal. It's very fitting. Just gotta drink some water. I mean, Estus. From my Estus flask.
Echo! Echo!
Remember Echo the Dolphin? That was a really creepy game. I don't think it was meant to be creepy, but it was very creepy. I think mostly because it's like, something about deep sea stuff is kind of unsettling. You'd think a game about being a dolphin and swimming through the sea would be really, like, comfy and nice. But that game is, it's pretty fucked up and I don't like it. It really... I didn't like it when I was a kid. Has it been 4 minutes yet? Okay. I'm gonna just hit the random button on the Dark Souls Wikipedia. Well, not Wikipedia. The wiki. Wiki. The sea is terrifying. It's dark. There's so much unknown stuff at the bottom of the sea.
Suck.
Okay. Here's my fancy screen with an animation courtesy of Kaidui-chan at twitter.com. Alright. Our first page is Havel the Rock. Havel the Rock, once Bishop Havel? Havel. Havel the Rock is a hostile enemy in Dark Souls. Location. At the bottom of the tower before the Taurus Demon Boss Arena, the player can use the Watchtower Basement Key or the Master Key to find Havel waiting at the end of the final staircase. Alternatively, the tower in which Havel is located can be accessed adjacent to the Hydra's area in Darkroot Basin. When using this entrance, which also requires one of the aforementioned keys, Havel will be waiting for the player at the right side from the door. Plot. The chosen undead finds Havel automatically hostile with no dialogue whatsoever, suggesting that Havel has long since gone hollow. He wields Dragon Tooth, the legendary Great Hammer. Havel's ring can be obtained after his defeat, while the rest of his equipment, armor, shield, and weapon, can be obtained in Anorlando. Lore.
Lore.
Havel the Rock was a close friend of Gwyn, and a general in what was presumably Gwyn's army. Havel was a steadfast and resilient man, inspiring his men to do great things. He and his warriors donned armor carved from solid rock, and war rings bestowing them with the ability to carry a heavier load. Bishop Havel despised magic users, thus creating the Miracle Grape magic barrier to counter them. Havel's own magic was only of a defensive nature, and his shield was imbued with it. Havel also had an intense hatred for Seath the Scaleless, grandfather of sorcery, who was his sworn enemy. Strategy. Havel proves to be a very dangerous and very powerful enemy, capable of easily killing lower vitality players, low armor players, and drain large levels of stamina in a single attack. The person who wrote this missed a word in there. His overhead strike can both break through guards and inflict critical damage. Havel takes very low damage from most starting weapons and tools, aside from pyromancies and weapons buffed with gold pine resin. However, his rather predictable and slow attack patterns means that he is particularly susceptible to backstabs and parrying. Chain parrying Havel is arguably the fastest way to dispatch him, but is the riskiest, as it requires the player to directly confront his attacks, and any minor error will likely mean death. Backstabbing is an easy but time-consuming strategy. Havel's overhead attacks will almost guarantee to miss if the player stands directly next to Havel and constantly strafes to either side, leading to an easy backstab. The Drake Sword can prove to be invaluable to low-level players, as it can be obtained nearby and is likely the only weapon that can deal bearable damage to Havel at such an early point in the game, especially with critical hits. He is unusually evasive for such a defensive NPC, favoring rolling when players use magic or ranged attacks. It may prove difficult to hit him if he decides to roll consistently, as he has surprisingly good timing. A rapid series of rolls will, however, drain a majority of his stamina, so one or two kicks can easily break his guard if he's blocking with his dragon too. Like the Capra Demon, Havel is very easily distracted with Oral Decoy. This can be used to take pressure off the player and possibly open a window for a backstab. He will not pursue the player beyond the threshold into Darkroot Basin, providing a quick escape route if necessary. It can be very effective to use the Oral Decoy strategy from this side as well. Havel can also be lured to chase the player to the top of the stairs. Jumping off the side of the stairs when he attacks will make him fall along with the player, inflicting fall damage. This process can be repeated to defeat him. Some means of healing, or fall control, can be used to survive the damage the player takes. The player can also lead Havel to either doorway, where he will not pursue the player any further. From here, the player can safely dispatch him by using toxins or poisons. Should the player choose to fight Havel in melee combat, it is highly recommended to lure him up to the level above him. Should the player die in their attempt, they can safely access their bloodstain before trying again. The next page is Soul of High Lord Wulnir. The Soul of High Lord Wulnir is a boss soul in Dark Souls 3. Spoilers! In-game description. Soul of the High Lord Wulnir. Wulnir. One of the twisted souls, steeped in strength, used to acquire many souls, or transposed to extract its true strength. Lord Wulnir of Karthus sentenced countless souls to gruesome deaths, keen to outlive them all. Lore. Availability. Obtained after defeating High Lord Wulnir in the catacombs of Karthus. usage. Consume to acquire 10,000 souls, or transpose with Ludlith to create either Wulnir's Holy Sword or the Black Serpent Pyromancy. Okay. It's time for the next page. Are you... The next page, I'm sorry, is replenishment. Replenishment is a miracle in Dark Souls 2. In-game description, an intermediate miracle gradually restores the user's HP. Though this miracle is commonly used by cleric warriors fighting on the front lines, it has a number of other applications, such as treating the sick. I need this. Availability. One copy is sold by Lysia of Lindelt for 3,000 souls. However, once the Looking Glass Knight is defeated, she will sell infinite copies. Sold by Cromwell the Pardoner for 3,000 souls. General information. When cast, replenishment restores 7 HP per second for 120 seconds, for a total of 840 HP. Prior to patch 1.04, replenishment could be cast alongside other personal buff spells, such as Immolation, in order to help restore any lost HP. However, after patch 1.04, casting replenishment will cancel out any pre-existing personal buff. Attunement milestones. Like most other spells, the amount of casts per slot increases upon reaching certain attunement milestones. Okay, it's time for the next page. Ooh, the next page is Jailer Handmaid. I really like these enemies. They look cool. Jailer Handmaids are enemies in Dark Souls 3. Description: maidens who survived the destruction of the capital. These robed priestesses continue to watch over the ruins. They resemble the jailers from the Earthild dungeon, although they wear white robes and wield daggers and flame lanterns rather than soldering irons. Soldering irons? They are also unable to drain the player's vitality by looking at them. Location: profaned capital. Strategy. The jailer handmaids only appear in the hall outside the boss room of Yorm the Giant, but their large numbers makes them dangerous opponents if they are alerted. It is advised to use ranged weapons to lure them away from the crowd if the player wishes to engage them. They will constantly cast fireballs at a distance, so moving in close is recommended. The handmaids will occasionally perform a lunging stab with their dagger, but their main close range attack is to shoot a cone of flame out of their lanterns. This attack has a large radius but can be completely avoided by moving behind the maiden. Just get in there. Don't give up, skeleton. Okay, it's time for the next page. Northern Helm. The Northern Helm is a head armor in Dark Souls 3. It is a part of the Northern set. In-game description. Iron helm of a stalwart northern warrior, engraved with an ornate pattern. Iron defensive wear grants superior stability. Being from the north, it should also offer resistance to the cold. Availability. Starting equipment for the warrior class. Found on a hanging corpse in the undead settlement, at the same area where the demon is fought alongside Siegward of Katarina. The next page is Minecraft 2, coming to Nintendo Switch, summer of 2019. Oops, I just leaked important E3 details. I'm sorry. Okay. Here is another page from the Dark Souls Wiki. Merchant Hag Malentia. Here's a quote. I don't really know what this character sounds like because I've never really played Dark Souls 2. So I'm just gonna assume they sound like really old and decrepit.
You may travel light, but methinks you bear a burden of your own. By my shit.
Merchant Hag Malentia is a merchant in Dark Souls 2. She is voiced by
Marcia Warren.
Location: found in the Forest of Fallen Giants, next to the Cardinal Tower bonfire. After exhausting all of her dialogue and defeating the last giant boss, she moves to Majula and settles on the left of the bonfire next to the wall. It's very specific. Plot. She sells various wares to the player, including pieces of armor, weapons, and sorceries. She will also sell the armor sets and weapons of certain characters if the player has killed them. If the player speaks to her, she provides some information about Drangleic's backstory. Malentia also sells Lenigrast's key, which opens blacksmith Lenigrast's workshop in Majula, allowing the player to use his smithing services. The covetous silver serpent ring plus one can be gifted to the player by spending 10,000 souls in her shop and exhausting her dialogue. It costs 4,000 souls to revive her. That's about as many souls as it would cost to revive me. Lore. The traveling merchant Malentia is one of the few Drangleic survivors. She is always seen carrying her wares on her back. Malentia also seems to be slowly losing her mind. Strategy. When she becomes hostile, she can inflict curse buildup, instantly turning the player hollow if the meter should fill. What does she sell? Let's take a look at her wares. What are you selling? Human effigy, times 5, for 1,500 souls. Life gem, times 10, for 300. Amber herb, times 3, for 1,600. Firebomb, for 200. Witching urn, for 400. Throwing knife for 100 souls. Pharos' lockstone for 4,000 souls. Lenigrast's key for 1,000. Radiant life gem for 1,000. Okay, it's time for the next page. Get ready for the next page. Da 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 da. The next page is Pilgrims. Pilgrims Spawn Toon. The Pilgrim Splatoon is a spear in Dark Souls 2, Crown of the Old Iron King. In-game description. Spontoon used by warriors on pilgrimage. Rather worn from the long journey it has doubtless seen. A spear which also doubles as a catalyst for sorceries, making it an ideal choice for light-footed pilgrims. Effect. Use sorcery.
Strong attack.
Availability. I love when I say a word and everyone just spams the word for the next 5 minutes. The Pilgrim's Splatoon is located in a hidden alcove next to an elevator in Broom Tower. The Scorching Iron Scepter is required to access it. Characteristics. The Pilgrim's Spontoon doubles as a staff in addition to being a spear, enabling users to cast sorceries and hexes at the cost of having no heavy attack. While it isn't the strongest catalyst available, it can be used to great effect against opponents with high physical defense and low elemental resistances. The same applies to shielded opponents. If their shield has low magic and/or dark resistance, then a lot of damage can be done through the block. At 3.5 units of weight, the Splatoon is tied with the basic spear for being the lightest spear available. This makes it effective as a secondary weapon, allowing the player more adaptability mid-fight without encumbering them too much. Oh no, I hope I don't get encumbered. Next page. This page is Yorshka's Chime. Yorshka's Chime is a sacred chime in Dark Souls 3. In-game description. A sacred chime belonging to Yorshka. Her brother, the former knight captain, presented her this medium together with another gift, her name. The ringing of the chime must have done much to soothe her loneliness. Skill, gentle prayer. Recovers HP for a period of time, albeit extremely slowly. Works while equipped in either hand. Availability. Dropped by accompanying Captain Yorshka in Anna Londo. You have to kill her? That's awful. So cruel. How could you? Characteristics. Yorshka's chime is one of the weakest sacred chimes at low amounts of faith, only providing better spell buff than the Saint Tree Bellvine. I like that. Rolls off the tongue. Saint Tree Bellvine. As well, it requires 30 faith in order to use, making it a poor overall choice for players who have not invested large amounts of faith. However, past 40 faith, its scaling increases drastically, and at 50 or higher faith, it becomes the most powerful miracle casting catalyst. At the soft cap of 60 faith, Yorshka's Chime has the highest spell buff for casting miracles in the game. Upgrades. Reinforced with Notes. Can be traded with Pico P in exchange for the Help Me Carving. I'm sorry, the
Help Me
Carving. Since getting this item requires that the player kills Captain Yorshka, it should be noted that the Dark Moon Blade and the Dark Moon Ring, both rewards in the Blade of the Dark Moon Covenant, will not be available anymore in that playthrough, unless the player acquires them both prior to killing her. Next page.
I'm sorry.
Hood of the Forlorn. The Hood of the Forlorn is a head armor piece in Dark Souls 2, Scholar of the First Sin. It is part of the Forlorn set. In-game description. Hood of the Forlorn, who wander the land of the undead. born of Algia's obsession with the first sin, the Forlorn lost both their corporeal form and a world to call their own. Now they drift into other worlds, ever in search of a home. But without self, one has neither beginning nor end, and so the Forlorn have only to wander. Availability. Purchased from Strait of Olaphis? For 3,600 souls. Great Axe. For other uses, see Great Axe Disambiguation. The Great Axe is a great axe in Dark Souls. Huh. The more you know. In-game description. This Great Axe is a veritable mass of iron. Its weight sends foes... I almost said it sends toes flying. I'm sorry. I've got feet on the brain, I'm sorry. Its weight sends foes flying, but it makes it difficult to handle without inhuman strength. So I'm the only person alive who can wield this properly, because I'm very, very strong. Any miss makes one very vulnerable, as each swing requires the full force of the body. Availability. Found in the depths, close to the bonfire and guarded by some rats. Sold by the Crestfallen Merchant for 8,000 souls. Dropped by Bear Knight Knights? Bernstein Bears? Characteristics. The Great Axe is the lightest Great Axe and easiest to wield one-handed. Otherwise, it is eclipsed by other Great Axes in terms of sheer damage later in the game due to its low scaling. Incidentally, this low scaling makes it a good candidate for elemental augmentation. The slow moveset and short reach of the Great Axe make it somewhat easy to avoid in PvP. The rest of this page is just a bunch of upgrades and whatnot. Okay, next page. What the hell is this? Millwood Knight Helm. The Millwood Knight Helm is a head armor in Dark Souls 3, Ashes of Ariandel. It is part of the Millwood Knight set. In-game description. Helm worn by Knights of Millwood, adorned with antlers believed to grow from the blessed beast of the ethereal oak. That's cool. When the fabled Millwood Forest was discovered, it was a vacant ruin. The only thing left was the ethereal oak. Stood rotting. No corpses were discovered, yet their belongings lay neatly on the ground. Availability. Purchased from the shrine handmaid for 5,000 souls after giving her the captain's ashes. Oh, I never got this because I forgot to get the captain's ashes. Oh well. What can you do? Next page! Oh, another Dark Souls 2 item. Illusory Ring of the Exalted. The Illusory Ring of the Exalted is a ring in Dark Souls 2. In-game description. A ring of green stone. The stone is misshaped, however imperceptibly. Renders certain equipment invisible. Do not judge your foes by their appearance. He who approaches without a sword carries two behind his back. That's what I say about my dickhead stepdad. Availability. Beat the game without resting at a bonfire. The ring is given to the player at the conclusion of the credits. General information. Whilst this ring is equipped, weapons in the player's right hand become invisible. It is the counterpart of the illusory ring of a conqueror. Strategy. By using soul-giving items to get 1 million souls, One can instantly pass the door at the Shrine of Winter and go to Drangleic Castle at the start of the game. This saves the player a lot of work, as only 7 bosses will be required to beat the game. A relatively easy way to acquire this ring for magic users is to wait until the first New Game Plus cycle to attempt the run. Prior to passing into New Game Plus, attune repair, any variant of heal, and any other magic one desires, then wear the crown of the old Iron King to restore casts. Repair and heal removes the 2 most common needs to rest at a bonfire, making the challenge a matter of patience. Next page. Oh no, how do you pronounce this? Lucerne? Hold on a second. How to pronounce?
Following pronunciation is brought to you by PronounceNames.com.
Wow, thank you.
Lucerne.
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 Lucerne. The Lucerne is a halberd in Dark Souls 3. In-game description. A pole arm with a sharp, hard, pronged head that inflicts thrust attacks. The Lucerne is wielded overhand like a hammer, or can be swung from the side to break through shields. Skill. Spin sweep. Sweep toes in a... Sweep toes in a large spinning motion and utilize momentum to transition into an overhand strong attack smash. Lucerne Smash! Availability. Found on a corpse at the high wall of Lothric, in the courtyard guarded by patrolling Lothric knights, just before encountering Vort of the Boreal Valley. Characteristics. The Lucerne is an interesting halberd, in that all of its attacks deal thrust damage, despite possessing no actual thrusting attacks. As its entire moveset is comprised of swings, it fills in a unique niche? Of being capable of inflicting thrust damage on groups of enemies. While it lacks the reach of dedicated thrusting weapons like spears and pikes, it can still be quite powerful in the right hands, especially if combined with a Leo ring. Of particular note is that when using its weapon art, the weapon's protruding beak is able to bypass shields. This can be useful when dealing with turtle builds. Am I turtly enough for the turtle club? Turtle, turtle. I accidentally touched my microphone cord and it scared me a lot. I hope it didn't hurt your ears. Next page. Ooh! These are the guys that have the white, gloppy stuff all over their heads. I like these. Grand Archive Scholar. Grand Archive Scholars are enemies in Dark Souls 3. In-game description. The scholars of the Grand Archives, sorcerers by craft, tend to their candles with a reverence that exceeds the simple burden of labor. They know dangers of the Archives' store of knowledge all too well. Ah, yes. Description. Eerie sages, sorcerers by craft, who tend the vast and irreplaceable bulk of knowledge stored within the archives. They wear religious robes and pace slowly along the library's corridors. They all wield a candlestick which strengthens the sorceries cast by some of them. All of them can be seen holding a small, unlit candle on their left hand, although only those with burning flames on their heads may use it to douse wax onto trespassers. I hate it when they do that. Press F if you hate it when the wax guys throw their wax at you and then you, like, stumble over and can't move because you're covered in wax. Hashtag relatable. Increase the text size on this page. Maybe I need glasses. Okay. There are two variants. Normal-sized scholars with their candles unlit. They mainly resort in performing melee attacks with their candlesticks, if you know what I mean. Burning candle. Slightly taller and stronger sages portraying a burning candle on their heads. They can unleash a series of magical attacks from very long distances and may quickly heat up the candle they hold with the flame on their heads to douse the player with hot wax, rendering them unable to sprint or roll for a short period of time. What a dick move that is. Locations. Only found throughout the library section of the Grand Archives.
Lore.
Remember to drink water. In Lothric, the scholar has long been considered one of the three pillars of the king's rule, and is therefore a master of the Grand Archives. Their candles, and the deliberate complete coverage they maintain on their heads, are made of an ivory wax that prevents the foulness of the texts from damaging and dislodging their anchors of reason. Strategy. Scholars mainly serve as supporting forces for other enemies. Even though they move very slowly, they may surprise the player with unexpected stabs and slashes with their candlesticks. Candlejack. The ones portraying burning flames. I'm just kidding. Press F if you remember Candlejack. Hashtag relatable. Hashtag old internet jokes. Hashtag drink water. The ones portraying burning flames on their heads are considerably stronger and may only fall with at least two hits from heavy weaponry. They will be the main concern while traversing through the archives while in search of the elusive Crystal Sage, as they can detect the player from very long distances and unleash several barrages of magical attacks in quick succession. It is advised to take care of any other enemies in their vicinity first and to have one's own head covered in wax the whole time, as they tend to stand in areas where a myriad of clawed curses may emerge. If possible, it is recommended to attack them from very far away by using a bow and arrows, thus giving the player a breathing room while evading the Crystal Sage's constant harassment. Vadi Vidya, please don't sue me. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Notes.
Immune to alluring skulls. That's another really good series of words. Alluring skulls. 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 Skull. Alluring skull. Alluring skull. Immune to rapport. Rapport? Rupert? Scholars will always detect the presence of the player once they have been approached by a certain... approach a certain distance, even if they don't produce sounds, either by wearing the slumbering dragon crest ring or by casting spooky. Trivia. Their body models and clothing are just modified versions of the two thinner variants of Deacons. Huh. The scholar ring portrays the picture of a scholar with his head accurately covered in wax. Their headgear, the scholar's shed skin, exists within the game's files and was supposedly intended to be dropped by them, although testing by using a 100% drop rate script has confirmed that it actually cannot be obtained in the game by conventional means. The more you know. It's time for the next page. Court Sorcerer Set. The Court Sorcerer Set is a light armor set in Dark Souls 3. In-game description. There are many sorcerers who claim heirship to the Great Sage Big Hat Logan, and the profaned capital house is one of two leading schools. Availability. Found in the profaned capital, in the toxic swamp area, climb up the ladder, I turned southern for a second there. Hey y'all, welcome to the toxic swamp. Praise the sun. Climb up the ladder and into the building. The set is located on a corpse next to the central pillar, guarded by a monstrosity of sin and mimic. Characteristics. Offers poor physical defenses, but strong elemental absorption. It can greatly mitigate lightning and dark damage, and has very high curse resistance. However, it is very weak to bleed and frost buildup. Next page. Rusted Iron Ring. The Rusted Iron Ring is a ring in Dark Souls, the video game. In-game description. This iron ring was used to shackle the guilty. It is terribly rusted and faintly stained with blood. Those who find this strange ring to their liking will be pleased to find it easier to gain footing on poor ground such as swamps. I should wear this ring whenever I go to Florida, am I right, folks? Ha 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 ha. Just past the door that is opened with the Undead Asylum F2 West Key in the upper level of the Undead Asylum. General information. Allows full movement regardless of environment. The ring is useful for going through Blighttown, as increased movement through the swamp decreases the likelihood of contracting poison. It will come in handy again during the fights with the Hydras, as well as traversing the pits of Lost Izalith. It is also helpful in Sen's Fortress, for fighting the Titanite demons in the pits under the first bridge. Its effect does stack with the Darkwood Grain Ring, allowing the player to ninja flip in swamp or other mobility-restricting terrain. Omae wa mou shindeiru. Next page. Nani? Drang Armor. For the Dark Souls 2 variant, see Lillian Armor. Oh, I am not bored. I am very much entertaining myself right now. You have no idea. The Drang Armor is a chest armor in Dark Souls 3. It is part of the Drang set. In-game description. Armor of the Drang Knights proclaim descendants of the land known for the legend of the Linking of the Fire. fine protection that is both light and strong, having been reinforced with rare G-steel. The Drang Knights were once feared sellswords, until treason meant descending into the abyss, and they were separated forever. Availability. Found in the Cathedral of the Deep, in the murky waters near the staircase that leads to the Deacons of the Deep, it is guarded by a giant slave, several writhing rotten flesh, and a man grub. Next page. Shoutouts to Fortmaster 69. Why am I doing this? The world may never know. Next page. Next page. Healing. Healing is a gameplay mechanic in Dark Souls. General information. Healing restores health, which can be done in a variety of ways and ultimately prevent death. The most basic way of healing is to simply rest at a bonfire. Enemies, such as the Bear Knight and Balder Knights, will have little to no poise. Poise. While drinking Estus flasks and can be staggered by nearly any weapon. Usage. Items. Divine Blessing. Estus Flask. Firekeeper Soul. Humanity. Twin Humanities. Elizabeth's Mushroom. Miracles. Bountiful Sunlight. Heal. Great Heal. Great Heal Excerpt. Replenishment. I need to replenish myself, hold on. Ah! Hell yeah. Soothing Sunlight. Rings. Ring of the Evil Eye. Weapons. Butcher Knife. Sanctus. Server. Minecraft Server. Smo's Hammer. Enemies. Occasionally, enemies and characters that can heal themselves or others are encountered. Characters. Forest Hunter Cleric. Soothing Sunlight. Nico of Thorlund. Replenishment. Paladin Leroy. Great Heal. I have a funny story, actually. I was playing the Dark Souls remaster a few days ago, and I got to the part where you fight Pinwheel, but I was rushing through it because I really wanted to get the mask. So I did the like skip where you jump down onto the ledge to get to the boss arena faster, and I saw that there was like a summon sign placed on one of the ledges. I've never done this like skip thing before, so I've never seen the summon sign on the ledge, and I assumed that it was like an actual human player person somewhere put that there because it was such an odd position for a summon sign. And I clicked on it and it said Paladin Leroy, and I thought, oh, this is just someone making a Leroy Jenkins joke. So I summoned them because I thought it would be funny, and they showed up and it was they had this like weird outfit on and a huge club, and I fought the boss and I was like, wow, this person is really good at the game. Even though the Pinwheel boss is really easy, it's just like, wow, they sure are powerful. And then I found out later that it wasn't a person, it was an NPC. That deserves the Seinfeld base theme. the official theme of Paladin Leroy from Dark Souls, the video game. Okay. Where was I? Enemies. Balder Knight. Estus Flask. Bear Nike Knight. Estus Flask. Hollow Soldier. Estus Flask. Painting Guardian. Estus Flask. Royal Sentinel. Great Heal Exit. I have the hiccups. Oh no. Next page. Black Knight Ultra Great Sword. The Black Knight Ultra Great Sword is an Ultra Great Sword in Dark Souls 2. In-game description. Ultra Great Sword wielded by knights who served a Lord of Light in a long-forgotten age. Even after their flesh was charred by flame, they remained as strong as ever and stood watch, challenging visitors to their land. Availability. Found in a metal chest, along with Great Fireball, in Brightstone Cove, Seldora. The chest is located behind a door on the right side of the room with the descending spiders. Descending spiders. The door can only be opened with the Brightstone Key, obtained by killing Duke Seldora, Toradora. Dropped by kobolds in Altia's keep. Broken Straight Sword. The Broken Straight Sword is a straight sword in Dark Souls. In-game description. Half of the blade of this straight sword is broken off. Only the completely hollowed would even consider using this as a weapon. Availability. Dropped by sword-wielding hollows. Dropped by sword-wielding infested ghouls found in the upper part of Blight Town. Characteristics. The broken straight sword has low reach and deals low damage. It is not used very often in combat. It is generally only used to create the Great Sword of Artorias. Fun fact, I just got 2 kittens. They're about 12 weeks old and they're very cute. And I love them so much. I love them with my entire soul and heart and life. And I named them after Kieran and Artorias from Dark Souls because I am very cool and only cool people name their pets after video game characters. But his name is Knight Artorias, so I just call him Knightly for short, because calling your cat Artorias is a bit of a mouthful sometimes, especially when they're like doing something bad and you're like, "Ah, Artorias, stop chewing on my headphone cord." But yeah, the more you know. Thank you so much for the super chats, by the way. Oh, and speaking of Toradora, press F if Taiga is the best Toradora. Press 1 if Ami is the best Toradora. And press 2 if Minori is the best Toradora.
If you don't press F, I'm reporting all of you.
I love my kittens with my entire dark soul. I used to be hollow, but when I gained kittens, I turned into human form. That's when you know you're a true gamer. I see a lot of Fs. Good job, everyone. The strong attack is the straight sword's family trademark vicious thrust with good range. which can then be followed by a quick vertical swing. The vertical swing has shorter reach than the thrust itself, so one should judge the distance carefully. Due to the broken straight sword's short length, the thrust attack is considerably shorter than any standard bladed straight sword. Along with the straight sword hilt, the broken straight sword is one of only two weapons that may be forged into the great sword of Artorias. Attempting to use the Soul of Sif with any other straight sword will result in the cursed variant.
Alright, next page.
Doopy doopy doop doop doop. Whoa!
Ghost Blade.
Not to be confused with Jagged Ghost Blade. The Ghost Blade is a dagger in Dark Souls. In-game description. The ghosts of New Londo clutch this wickedly sharp dagger with their bony hands and make mincemeat of the living. Fun fact, mincemeat actually doesn't really refer to meat. It's actually a word for like smushed up fruit and vegetables. I learned that from watching an episode of Desperate Housewives. The more you know. One of the cursed weapons which can inflict damage upon ghosts. Oh, thank you, Sasha Smith. Cha-cha slide. I'll do a nyan for you. Nyan. Availability. Drop from the Banshee in the New Londo Ruins. Since the drop rate is only 1%, without boosting item discovery, and there are only two Banshees that drop it, multiple runs may be required.
Characteristics.
The Ghost Blade has the rare curse effect, making it a valuable. What the hell? A valuable weapon when going through New Londo. The Ghost Blade has the highest base damage of all the daggers. However, it cannot be buffed, does not cause bleed, and has the second lowest, although still significant, critical modifier of all daggers. Although it is listed as a slashing and thrusting weapon, almost the entirety of its moveset uses slash attacks.
Slash. Cha-cha real smooth.
Turn it out. To the left. Take it back now, y'all. Two offs this time.
Flynn.
Flynn is a mentioned character in Dark Souls 2 and Dark Souls 3. A ring addressed to have belonged to him first appeared in Crown of the Sunken King. Russian accent. My problem is that when I'm like alone and I'm just goofing off, I can do accents just fine, but when someone asks me to do an accent, I just completely mess it up and sound like a complete fool. Like, I'll try to do a British accent and sound southern out of nowhere. How does that happen?
Flynn was a legendary thief.
I sound like Donkey Kong. Known as being a tiny fighter who packed a mighty punch, even the most skilled warriors in the land failed to capture him. You can't study because I'm making dumb cha-cha slide jokes, I'm sorry. I love cha-cha slide. I would do a Midwestern accent, but that's just my normal accent. I'm trapped in Midwestern hell. It was said that he fought with the strength of the wind at his side and was a hero among the weak and poor, although even his admirers knew that this was a little more than an idyllic fable. Idyllic. I keep getting Dark Souls 2 things. I've never played that. Demon's Great Axe. Yeehaw, I'm from Michigan. I say big instead of bag. For the Dark Souls variant, see Demon's Great Axe. The Demon's Great Axe is a soul-transposed Great Axe in Dark Souls 3. I just cracked my knuckles. I'm sorry. In-game description. This great axe, a favorite among demons, contains the strength of fire. The demons, born of chaos, harbor fire, and yet they are twisted and malformed, such that they were never meant to be. Sounds like me. Skill, demonic flare. Briefly cause flame within to flare, and smash it upon earth and toes. Availability. Transpose the soul of a demon with Ludlith of Corland. I have played Dark Souls, the first Dark Souls, and Dark Souls 3, and I have played the Ashes of Ariandel DLC for Dark Souls 3, but I haven't played the Ringed City DLC yet. But I plan to. I'm gonna stream it on Twitch. I did a stream of my first Dark Souls playthrough on Twitch, like a couple years ago. And just a few months ago, I did a stream of my Dark Souls 3 playthrough on Twitch. And I think my next video game stream is going to be, I dropped my cap of my water bottle. Holy fucking hell. I'm sorry, I cursed. My next Twitch stream is gonna be the Dark Souls Remastered for PC video game. I'm excited to do that. So, you can follow me on twitch.tv/nyoners. With a Z at the end. I can't stream video games on YouTube or I'll get in trouble because I'm partnered with Twitch and you're not supposed to stream video games on other platforms. Although streaming other stuff like Whispering Dark Souls item descriptions is fine. Please don't send me to jail. Undead Parish. The Undead Parish is a location in Dark Souls. It is a small area containing both the new and the old Undead Church, along with various other buildings. Adjacent locations. Undead Burg. Darkroot Garden. Firelink Shrine. An elevator becomes operational after it is activated from the parish. Sen's Fortress. Opens after the player has rung both bells of awakening. Bonfires. There are two bonfires in the Undead Parish area, both of which are warping points. Sunlight Altar Warping Point. After the Taurus Demon, across the bridge and beyond the threshold that is guarded by the Hellkite Dragon. Undead Parish Warping Point. Beyond the Baronic Knight, I still don't know how to pronounce that. In the structure across the narrow bridge leading from the Undead Parish Church. Parish Church. It is found in the old Undead Church above Andre the Blacksmith. Good ol' Andre. Covenant. Warrior of Sunlight. Can be joined either by praying at the Sunlight Altar, or talking to Solaire once he arrives at said altar. characters: Andre of Astora, Knight Lautrec of Kareem, trapped in a cell requiring the Mystery Key. If the player frees him, he can later be summoned as a White Phantom for the Bell Gargoyles fight. I just kick him off the ledge. Fuck that guy. Oswald of Kareem appears after ringing the bell within the parish. Rhea of Thorland, after rescuing her from the Tomb of the Giants. Solaire of Astora, summonable for the Bell Gargoyles fight. He also appears near the Sunlight Altar bonfire, after defeating Ornstein and Smo in Anorondo, where he can initiate players into the Warrior of Sunlight Covenant. There's a bunch of items and stuff. Trivia! The portcullis behind the Fangboar is closed when the player approaches too close to it, which causes the armored zombie closest to it to rush behind it and pull the lever. As such, it can be prevented from closing by aggroing this armored zombie with a ranged attack, thus preventing it from being there to close the gate. I didn't know that. Wow, I actually did not know that. The more you know. Should I switch up the music sometime soon? Is this getting too repetitive? Or do you like the menu theme? I like it. I like it okay. Peter Parker and Spider-Man! Tag your spoilers, please. You just ruined it for me. Aquamarine Dagger. Ooh, woo. The Aquamarine Dagger is a dagger in Dark Souls 3, The Ringed City. In-game description. A dagger fitted with aquamarine crystal, engraved with a prayer in the old tongue to ward off incident. Perhaps it was a parting gift given to one set off on great travels. Skill: Crystal Blade. Release magic for the aquamarine crystals, creating a fleeting blue crystal blade, lengthy enough to swing as a straight sword. Do you have to charge the crystal? Availability. In the dreg heap, drop down the ledges where Gale is pointing, and once at the bottom turn left, you will see a Herald Legion Knight. Go up the stairs near the knight and you will see the dagger. Characteristics. When not transformed, the aquamarine dagger handles much like a standard dagger infused with a crystal gem would. Steven's Universe! Dealing split physical magical damage while scaling with intelligence, but lacks a high critical modifier. Its moveset remains unchanged as well, consisting of quick slashes, stabs, and thrusts. Do you want the Firelink theme? Dark Souls. Dark Souls Firelink theme. Extended. This is 10 hours of the Firelink Shrine theme. How melancholic. I'm the crestfallen yawners now. However, the true nature of this dagger lies in its transformed state, which is activated through use of the weapon's skill. Activating the aquamarine dagger skill will create a thin blade of crystal around the main blade of the dagger, effectively transforming it into a straight sword. In order to maintain this effect, one will need to maintain hold of the skill. Once transformed into a straight sword, the weapon gains additional moves. Performing a light attack will make the player perform quick slashes from side to side by Ariana Grande, covering a rather large area in front of them. Each of these attacks costs 2 FAP points. Performing a slong attack. Performing a slong attack. Performing a strong attack will lunge the player forward slightly, with the crystallized blade being twirled and then thrust forward, which can chain into either a strong horizontal slash or a combo of light attacks. The strong attacks cost 3 FAP points each. Rolling into the skill performs a twirl into a left to right slash that costs 8 FP. Running into the skill performs stop making me laugh into a forward thrust that costs 8 FP. While transformed, the magical damage of the dagger is amplified. Da-da-da-dum! Dual charm. Dual wield! Dual charms are throwable items in Dark Souls 3. In-game description. Tool used in duels of judgment. Nulls effects of special area effects for a short time. All Father Lloyd's knights lived in fear of his duels of judgment, in which verdicts were carried out by his sword of law. Availability. Firelink Shrine. Sold by the shrine handmaid for 500 souls each after she is given the paladin's ashes. Cathedral of the Deep. Dropped by Mangrubs. Effect. When a target is caught in the radius of the charm's mist, it prevents any spells or buffs from being cast or reapplied for 25 seconds. In addition, it will also completely nullify any special skills, buffs, and augmentations that were already cast or active at the time. Getting hit by one does not drain one's FP, but merely prevents it from being used. Usage. Multiple of these items can prove to be very useful in PvP encounters, as they allow to prevent the use of buffs. Lothric Knight Helm. The Lothric Knight Helm is a head armor piece in Dark Souls 3. It is part of Lothric Knight set. In-game description. Armor of a celebrated Lothric Knight. A strong steel helm, if a little worn. Wolnir. The knight has served as one of the three pillars since ancient times and shares place alongside the wyverns as a symbol of Lothric. Only those possessing a knight's resolve are fit to wear this garment. Availability. Dropped by Lothric Knights in the High Wall of Lothric, Lothric Castle, Grand Archives, and the Dreg Keep. Thanos dies. Oh no, it's gonna scroll up. Shoot. Heck. Thanos dies in The Legend of Dark Souls 2. Majora's Ocarina of Sonic the Hedgehog, Scholar of the First, Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Sega. Tom Clancy! Large soul of a weary warrior. This is my soul. The large soul of a weary warrior is a consumable soul item in Dark Souls 3. In-game description. Large soul found in the corpse of a battle-weary warrior. Used to acquire a large amount of souls. Let the Firekeeper transform this sovereignless soul into a source of strength. For to be unkindled is to be a vessel for souls. Usage. Consume to acquire 8,000 souls. Notes. Higher version of the soul of a weary warrior and lesser than the soul of a crestfallen knight. Swole Souls. Blue Wooden Shield, Dark Souls 3. The Blue Wooden Shield is a medium shield. Sorry, my back hurts. In Dark Souls 3. In-game description. A wooden shield painted bright blue, the symbol of clerics who have become undead. Close to a small shield in size. Wooden shields are light, manageable, and offer relatively high magic absorption. Skill. Parry. Repel an attack at the right time to follow up with a critical hit. Works while equipped in either hand. Availability. Starting equipment of the cleric class. Player class, that's a tongue twister. Found on a corpse in the graveyard in the undead settlement. Upgrades. Reinforced with titanite. Undead Peasant. That's another name for me. Undead Peasants, also known as Hollow Peasants, are enemies in Dark Souls 2, found in Brightstone Cove, Toradora, at the encampment. Description. Undead Peasants are the former inhabitants of Toradora, a town erected in a mountainous valley, now gone hollow. They can be seen wielding tools usually associated with rural activities, such as sickles, pickaxes, and torches. Some of these weapons, however, come imbued with an energy which causes curse buildup on attack. Strategy. Undead peasants are usually found in groups, either accompanied by other peasants or by parasite spiders. Also another name for me. The first peasant can be encountered near the Royal Army Campsite Bonfire in Brightstone Cove, tending to the remains of some unfortunate victims. Downhill from that place, a large group of peasants await an ambush prepared for any unwary travelers who dare enter their village. Peasants have the potential of killing the player if they manage to crowd on them. However, they usually aren't a big threat on their own. It is best to be cautious, as their attacks can appear misguiding, chasing attack, and stun lock the player, which would give time to the rest of the crowd for some heavy and damaging hits. Oh, thank you, Austin Cargill. Thank you. Thank you. Explore. Random page. Great Magic Barrier. Great Magic Barrier is a miracle in Dark Souls. In-game description. Miracle of Bishop Havel the Rock. Cover body in powerful death magic coating. Defensive magic coating? Ooh, I have the hiccups. Havel the Rock, an old battlefield compatriot of Lord Gwyn, was the sworn enemy of Seath the Scaleless. He despised magic and made certain to devise means of counteraction. availability. Found in Ash Lake, inside the hollow tree. When entering the tree normally, the spell will be unreachable. To reach it, the player must walk on the branch outside, the one with a basilisk on it, and stop halfway. Turn the camera and fall down onto a lower branch. General information. Great Magic Barrier greatly increases magic resistance for its duration. Great Magic Barrier is considered a personal buff, and thus cannot be used in conjunction with any other personal buffs, such as Power Within, Flash Sweat, or even Green Blossoms, etc. And there's some pictures on this page. There's a picture of the location of the Great Magic Barrier item in the tree, the Great Hollow. Oh boy, oh boy. Peanut butter. Did somebody say peanut butter? What's the next page? What do we have here? Sunlight Maggot. The Sunlight Maggot is a unique head armor in Dark Souls. In-game description, a loathsome parasite that inhabit Lost Izalith. It is completely immobile, yet still lives. Same. When worn on the head, it emanates blinding light, which is why it's known as a Sunlight Maggot. Availability. The Sunlight Maggot is obtained as a drop from the Red-Eyed Chaos Bug, a unique mob that is found past the shortcut door separating the demon ruins from Lost Izalith. Opening the door requires the player to have reached rank 2 in the Chaos Servant Covenant with the Spider Waifu, or by going behind the Titanite Demon in Lost Izalith. There are a total of 9 Chaos Bugs on both sides of the shortcut door. The Sunlight Maggot can only be obtained once per playthrough, since the red-eyed chaos bug will not respawn. It can also be obtained by killing Solaire of Astora if the red-eyed chaos bug has not been killed before speaking to him after killing the centipede demon. Characteristics. Suck. The Sunlight Maggot emanates light when worn as a helmet, making it useful for exploring dark areas such as the Tomb of the Giants. I hate that place. Cannot be upgraded, however, and offers poor physical defense and resistances, with the exception of very high fire resistance, limiting its utility to exploration. It can be used as an alternative to the Skull Lantern, as it does not sacrifice the ability to block, and does not have to be cast like Cast Light. Notes: the Sunlight Maggot can be traded to Snuggly the Crow once per playthrough for the Old Witch's Ring. This item appears to be the sun Solaire of Astora is searching for, as he will go insane if you don't kill the Chaos Maggot that drops this item, and he can he can be seen wearing it and speaking of it as his son. Time for water. This is heaven, I am God, and welcome to my Christian Minecraft server. Please do not cuss, and take your shoes off at the door. Snuggly the Crow.
You, give me warm, give me soft. Snuggly the Crow.
Snuggly the Crow is an invisible NPC in Dark Souls with a fat ass. She is similar to Sparkly the Crow in Demon Souls in the way that particular items can be exchanged with her to receive other useful items. Location. Snuggly is located in the northern undead Asylum, on a small ridge to the right of the asylum building, right before the cliff where the chosen undead is grabbed by the giant crow, and where a larger nest appears after the player returns to the asylum from Firelink's shrine. Many players get confused about which nest it is. The nest where Snuggly is located is not the same in which the player is dropped. Instead, walking forward about 20 feet forward toward the asylum and turning left will reveal the trading location. Dropping an item in the wrong nest will cause permanent loss of said item. Oh no! Not my items! Exchanges. In order to exchange items with Snuggly, one must drop an item in her nest and wait for her response. If she says, "No, no, that no soft, that no warm," she won't accept it. If she does not respond, she will accept it. Please respond. Successfully completing the trade can be done in many ways. The player can quit and reload, use Homeward Bone or Homeward Miracle, or fall off the ledge and return to the nest. Remember to rest at the bonfire in the asylum first. The item should be in her nest. However, each item trade can only be performed once per playthrough. Then there's a table of all the known trades. There's a lot of them. For example, you can trade a Xanthus crown for the Ring of Favor and Protection. Notes. It is impossible to exchange more than one item at a time in order to make multiple trades. For example, if one puts down two blood-red moss clumps, one will still receive only one twinkling titanite. However, everything can be exchanged again during subsequent playthroughs. Dropping two different items will result in only the first one being traded. Trivia. She is never seen or spoken to directly. Similarly to Sparkly the Crow in Demon Souls, she only speaks to the player. The name Snuggly is never heard within the game. Snuggly the Crow got her name when a Dark Souls player called her Snuggly during pre-release playtesting. I didn't know that. Although it does say citation needed after that. Bugs. It was once possible to trade for more items at once with a glitch. Simply put the desired item in the nest and quit the game. Reload, and before picking up the new item, place the same item again. Quit and reload, and there will be two of the same new items there. This can be done multiple times until the player finally picks up the items. This bug has been fixed as of patch 1.05. Are you getting sleepy? I need some freaking water. Time to get hydrated. King Seeker Framped. I will now attempt to do a Kink Seeker. Kink Seeker Framped voice. Thank you, Pudiable. Glad you like my covers.
Hmm?
No, no, I'm fine, I'm fine. Well and wide awake. Do not treat me like an old withering snake.
Kingseeker Frampt. Kingseeker Frampt is a character in Dark Souls. He is a primordial serpent who seeks to find the human replacement for Gwyn, Lord of Cinder. He is voiced by me, who also voiced Darkstalker Koth and the Gerber Baby. Location: Firelink Shrine, where the pool in front of the decrepit statue used to be. Kingseeker Frampt only appears after the Bells of Awakening have been rung.
Coffee.
Plot: Kingseeker Frampt appears in Firelink Shrine after the player rings both Bells of Awakening. He instructs the player to go to Edelondo and obtain the Lord Vessel. After the player obtains the Lord Vessel, Frampt transports them to an entrance of the Kiln of the First Flame and instructs the player to place the Lord Vessel to gain access to the Kiln and to ultimately kill Gwyn and prolong the Age of Fire. Should the player give the Lord Vessel to Koth instead, Frampt will become irate and leave the player for the rest of the playthrough. Fun fact, on my first playthrough, I came back, I had the Lord Vessel, and I was like, alright, this old snake man wants me to place the Lord Vessel on the altar, but when I came back, he was asleep, and I was like, oh no, how do I wake him up? I don't want to, like, hit him with my sword or something, because what if he gets mad that I hit him? And I didn't know that you could do that, but I did know that you could jump down into the pit that it comes out of to go place the Lord Vessel, so I was like, alright, I'll just jump on down there and go do that. And I did it, and when I came back, he was really mad. Because apparently, if you don't place it when he's present, he assumes that you placed it for the other guy, and gets mad and leaves forever, so for the rest of my playthrough, I couldn't feed him my dung pies anymore, and I was really sad. Notes. Green Tea Gang. When Frampt transports the player to the Firelink Altar after retrieving the Lord Vessel, it is not necessary to place it. By using a Homeward Bone or the Homeward Miracle, it is possible to exit and continue using Frampt's feeding service. Frampt's feeding service. That's wonderful. And at the same time, interact with Koth and join the Dark Wraiths. As long as the player does not place the Lord Vessel, neither serpent will depart. The player should avoid attacking Frampt unless he is asleep, as it may result in him leaving for the rest of the playthrough. If this happens, the player loses access to his feeding service and must either place the Lord Vessel with Koth or do it alone by dropping down the hole Frampt was in. Dropping down to the Firelink Altar after acquiring the Lord Vessel without his help will make Frampt leave, even if the player didn't place it. I wish I knew. If you place the Lord Vessel while he is sleeping, and then proceed to kill a Great One, he will go back to the slumber in anticipation for the Chosen Undead the next time you speak to him, leaving him unavailable for the rest of the playthrough. Trivia. Shortly after Frampt's arrival, the crestfallen warrior, who sits fairly close to Frampt, complains about a horrible smell. This is likely referring to Frampt. The crestfallen warrior will leave after being spoken to when Frampt is around, so keep that in mind before ringing the second Bell of Awakening. The crestfallen warrior can be later found as a hostile hollow at the New Londo Ruins. Stinky snake boy.
Ooh, he's so stinky. Ooh, stinky little snake. Ooh, I just stink up the entire place with my stinky old snake
Anyway, in previous versions of the game, there was a glitch where if a player jumped down the hole, Franz sticks his head out of, but quit and loaded before reaching the bottom. They would reach the kiln of the first flame. In doing so, players could skip gathering the Lord Souls and go straight to the fight against Gwyn. This technique has been used for speedruns of the game. If the players have given Koth the Lord Vessel already, then it is possible to prevent Frampt from leaving by rushing around and away from him. As long as he doesn't finish his dialogue, he won't disappear. Players can also prevent him finishing his dialogue by attacking him. It's actually possible to kill Kingseeker Frampt, but only through the use of third-party programs. Frampt has 11,120 HP and drops 5,000 souls after being killed. Frampt will randomly be found sleeping deeply, usually after resting at a bonfire, even if he was spoken to only moments ago. He can be awoken by attacking him. Kicking and punching are sufficient. After ringing the first bells of awakening, Frampt can be heard snoring when passing through the flooded area of Firelink Shrine, of which he will eventually emerge. Strangely, this makes a collectible, invisible humanity sprite, one that increases your character's liquid humanity by 1 point, spawn nearby. It is possible to collect this sprite by falling from the nest above, or one of the ledges above, but the fall may kill the character in the process, forcing the character to run back to his bloodstain from the last bonfire they saved at. It is also possible to collect this sprite by passing through Frampt's room. It seems to often be near the fallen pillar that lays diagonally on the ground, one end of the pillar pointing to the starting origin bonfire Firelink Shrine, and the other end of the pillar pointing to the graveyard leading to the catacombs. Frampt is one of the few characters whose mouth moves while talking. His mouth makes a really disgusting noise. It's like his teeth mashing together. It really does sound like he has really horrible breath. It's like... That's the sound he makes when he eats the poop that I feed him. I love you, Kingseeker Frampt. On the breastplate of Lord Gwyn's robes, there are patterns and indents that resemble Frampt's head, possibly as an indicator of their friendship, as mentioned by Koth. It would seem Frampt has a great dislike of Executioner Smough, Seath the Scaleless, and his followers. If fed any of their items, he will only give a single soul in exchange. Wow. There's a picture of Frampt hanging upside down, and his little like mustache tendril things are swinging about. What a goofy boy. Do 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 do. Do 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 do. Everybody was Dark Souls fighting. Time for the best Dark Souls girl. Crossbreed Priscilla. Here is a quote by Crossbreed Priscilla. Why could thou not let us be? Didst thou not see why Ariamis created this world? Priscilla. The best Dark Souls girl. Crossbreed Priscilla is an optional boss found in the painted world of Ariamis, and a character in Dark Souls. She is initially non-hostile, and will ask the player to leave the world without fighting. She is voiced by Claire Corbett, who also voiced the undead female merchant, and Guinevere, Princess of Sunlight. I swear to God, if you kill Priscilla, you are the worst. The absolute worst. You should be ashamed. lore. Priscilla is a crossbreed of an everlasting dragon and either a human or a god, due to her impressive height. Please step on me. Her exact parentage is unknown, and it is unlikely she is the daughter of any other character who appears in the game. She has fur over most of her body, making her more similar to the true everlasting dragons than to Seath the Scaleless. Furthermore, she is feared and mistreated by the gods, while Seath is a trusted duke. It's not fair. Priscilla wields the Life Hunt Scythe, a weapon so powerful that even the gods feared her. She was locked away in the painted world of Ariamis, presumably to keep the real world safe from her. However, when the player reaches her, she reveals that she is well aware of how to leave the painting, and simply chooses to remain. She is also initially not hostile unless provoked, and even claims the painted world to be peaceful, and its inhabitants kind. Given the fact that Priscilla's dagger deals occult damage, and due to the painted world of Ariamis also being filled with various things that are associated with the goddess Velka, weapons and relics that pose a threat to the gods. It's possible that Priscilla may have had something to do with Velka, which may be a major reason why she was locked in the painted world in the first place. Ooh, woo. Strategies. For the fight with crossbreed Priscilla, it is wise to not fight Priscilla because you're an awful person and just jump off the ledge. Also, something that I noticed is that I wasn't looking at her feet for a weird reason, I swear, but I just noticed that she has like pink nail polish on her toenails, and it really like confuses me because apparently they have nail polish in the Dark Souls universe. Like, did she apply it? How did she make the nail polish? How did she acquire nail polish? Did her like little crow friends go crush some bugs or something and make it into pink nail polish for her? Did they apply the nail polish to her toes? I need answers, okay? This is really important. Trivia. According to a developer interview, crossbreed Priscilla was initially meant to become the main heroine, similar to the Maiden in Black in Emerald Herald, and she was originally meant to be present in Firelink Shrine. However, this role was scrapped and replaced by the characters known as Firekeepers. Priscilla has unique and unused sitting and standing animations, further indicating that she was initially meant to be an ally to the player. Given that stories are told about her being the mistress of the painted world by the storytellers, could mean that she was canonically was not killed by the chosen undead and lived many years. Good. If that is true, then she likely was present when the original painting was replaced in the Burning of the Old, meaning that she is canonically dead, at least in that way. No! It's not true! Pink nail polish was one of the first colors to be created and was a status symbol. Only royalty would have it though. Priscilla is royalty, at least to me. She is my queen. She rules my life. Patches. For other uses, see Patches Disambiguation. Here's a quote from Patches. I mean, from Knight Lautrec of Kareem, about Patches. Have you heard of trusty Patches? If ever a man has rubbed me up the wrong way, ugh. If he ever comes around again, I swear I'll have his hide. Patches, also known as Trusty Patches, is a character in Dark Souls and a real fucker. He is an opportunist trickster with a hatred towards clerics. He is voiced by William Vanderpew, who also voiced Unbreakable Patches and Amnesiac Lap in Dark Souls 3, Patches the Hyena in Dark Souls, and Patches the Spider in Bloodborne. Location. Initially in the catacombs, if the player visits it early enough, until entering the Tomb of the Giants. Wait, hold up. Artorias has removed voice lines? He has a voice? Whoa. I have to read that next. Remind me. Initially in the catacombs, if the player visits it early enough until entering the Tomb of the Giants, he can still appear in the catacombs after ringing the Bells of Awakening if the player hasn't spoken to Petrus. In the Tomb of the Giants until Gravelord Nido is defeated. At Firelink Shrine, after the defeat of Nido, as a merchant. Face Kingseeker Frampt, turn left towards the doorway leading to the catacombs, and turn left before the stairs, and a little cove should be Patches squatting down and facing Frampt's direction. Plot. When the player first meets Patches, he will ask, "Are you a cleric?" Answering yes will result in him attacking the chosen undead, instead of later offering wares if the player had answered no with this question. Other characters such as Lautrec express misgivings about Patches before the player can even encounter him. This can be a tip to players new to the Souls games that Patches is not trustworthy. If visited before ringing either Bells of Awakening, Patches appears in the first half of the catacombs next to a bridge lever. Although he is seemingly neutral, his intentions are less than friendly. Upon attempting to cross a bridge, he will attempt to kill the player by flipping it. Players may survive by either running back before the flip animation starts, or rolling off the bridge onto the conveniently placed ledge to the right of the center of the bridge. If not spoken to before attempting to cross, speaking to him after will have him give the player a soul of a lost undead. Speaking to him before attempting to cross, then speaking to him again after he flips the bridge, will cause him to ask if the bridge flip caused any trouble. Answering yes has him give the player a humanity. He will remain in the catacombs until the player enters the Tomb of the Giants. Flip it! Patches is encountered again early on in the Tomb of the Giants, not far from the earliest available bonfire. He will attempt to trick the player into looking over the edge of a cliff, and will promptly kick them off. Upon making their way back to him, Patches will beg forgiveness, asking if he was still a friend. Answering no prompts Patches to give the player one twin humanities. I don't live in Washington, D.C. I live in Washington State. Patches remains in the Tomb of the Giants until the player defeats Gravelord Nido, upon which he will travel to Firelink Shrine, in an alcove near Frampt, and remain there as a vendor for the rest of the game. Panties sells some useful items, many of which are of limited stock, as well as assorted cleric equipment, likely collected from earlier victims. Lore. Little to nothing is known about Patches and his background. He has been previously acquainted with Shiva of the East, Solaire of Astora, Lautrec of Kareem, and Petrus of Floriland. Patches' very existence implies that he is transuniversal, or at least has a version of himself in every reality, the Hyena in Demon Souls, the Spider in Bloodborne, and the Trusty Unbreakable in Dark Souls. Wow. He is eternal. Notes. Patches can initially be found in the catacombs if that's the first place the player goes, but if avoided for enough time, certain events will lead to him being completely absent if approached later on. Patches is the only merchant who sells the Crescent Axe, the Cleric Set, the Mask of the Father, Mother, Child, and Eyes of Death. If attacked using the Dark Hand special attack, up to 7 liquid humanity can be obtained. As with other similar NPCs, using the Dark Hand will not spark any hostility towards the player. In the catacombs, moving panties away from the switch via Dark Hand, kicking, exit, and reload or wearing the Ring of Fog will allow the player to cross the bridge once without stopping. Remaining on the bridge for too long will give Patches enough time to walk toward the switch and activate it. Sometimes you can get to the other side and back without Patches noticing. He will still apologize and give a humanity after. Patches cannot be attacked with the Dark Hand when encountered at Firelink's Shrine while he is in his sitting position. Kicking him will force him to stand up without making him aggressive. The pizza is aggressive. I want pizza now. Strategy. Patches will use his spear to his advantage and attack the player with his shield up. Backstabbing can work well, though Patches may not leave his back open often. He will always die straight away after backstabbing. Doesn't die after backstabbing me, am I right, gamers? Alright, it's time to read the Artorias page. Gah! Knight Artorias. I always save my YouTube and Twitch VODs for later viewing for those who have missed the live stream. Just cause it's a nice thing to do. I'm sorry I crackled my water bottle extremely loudly. ASMR, ASMR, ASMR. My friend Lipgloss told me that she really hates when people do quotes. British accents, quote. So I wonder... I don't know if she's listening right now, but I want to make her cringe really hard. So I'm going to read this quote with a really horrible British accent. I love you, lip gloss. After I cough a little bit. This is a quote by Elizabeth. The mushroom lady. Shit, how do you do a British accent? I love the echo. It makes me feel like I'm trapped in a well and I'm dying. Thou shalt see further on, an abyss was begot of the ancient beast, and threatens to swallow the whole of Ulasil. Knight Artorias came to stop this, but such a hero has nary a murmur of dark. Without doubt, he will be swallowed by the abyss, overcome by its utter blackness. Indeed, the abyss may be unstoppable. I hope Lipgloss hears that and feels like she's going to hell. Knight Artorias, also known as Artorias the Abysswalker, and my cat, who is 12 weeks old and very cute, is a boss in Dark Souls, and my cat. He is exclusive to the Artorias of the Abyss DLC, and my house where my cat lives. My cat, Artorias, also known as Knightly for short. Location. Knight Artorias is located in the Coliseum area of Ulasil Township, At the end of the royal wood. Description. By the time the chosen undead encounters him, he is shown to have already been corrupted by the abyss. The result for his armor's putrefied appearance and the aura of darkness that it oozes, and it looks really fucking cool. His crippled arm is likely the result of Artorias halting the spread from devouring his wolf companion by means of a now-missing shield. Prepare to cry. He possesses a great sword that has also been consumed, yet is still far from ineffective. Having lost his sanity, the knight moves about in an untamed manner as he howls beneath the blue shroud of his helm. Lore!
The winner for best game.
Oh my god, it started playing a video. The winner of blah 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 blah. Sir Artorias, the Abysswalker, was one of the four knights of Lord Gwyn. He only makes an appearance in the past, as he is deceased by the time the chosen undead escapes the undead asylum. Knight Artorias wore distinctive armor as well as the wolf ring and brandished his great sword and great shield. He is known to have been a friend of Alvina of the Forest Hunter Covenant, and Sif, the great gray wolf, was his companion, who now guards his grave and keeps the Covenant of Artorias ring in his possession. Artorias hunted the Dark Wraiths and was able to traverse the abyss with the power of his ring, which he obtained after making a covenant with the beast there, preventing him from being swallowed by the void, but cursing his sword in the process. He had the power of God and anime on his side. In recognition of his actions, he was awarded one of Anerlanda's treasures, a silver pendant that allowed him to repel dark sorceries. Wah! When Ulasil became threatened by the abyss created by Anus, Artorias and his wolf companion Sif arrived there in an attempt to save Ulasil and rescue the abducted princess Dusk. However, the two were overwhelmed, and Artorias sacrificed himself to protect Sif, using his cleansing great shield, erecting a barrier around the young wolf. I really can't talk. Swallowed by the dark, he became corrupted along with his already cursed sword. He was then laid to rest by the chosen undead after their encounter in the Colosseum of Ulasil. I will never scream. I will never make a loud noise on purpose. Because this is for relaxation. I need you to trust me. Put your trust in me. This is the relaxation station, and I am the train conductor, and you're along for the ride. Have a safe and pleasant trip. Once defeated, Hawkeye Go mentions you defeating Artorias and speaks of him when talked to multiple times. His legacy as a hero lasted for centuries. By the time of Lothric, there was the undead legion of Faerun, who were commonly called the Abyss Watchers. They partook of wolf blood, and it is said that their souls are bound together and are one with the soul of the wolf blood master. Most likely Artorias, wielding greatswords modeled after his, and fighting in wild, ferocious styles, the Legion fought a veritable war with the Dark of the Abyss that their master had fought ages past. I love the Abyss Watchers. They're so cool. They're just a bunch of Artorias cosplayers, but I love them. Their outfit is so badass. I really want to cosplay an Abyss Watcher. It would be really hard because it's very complicated and there's lots of armor involved. How do you even make armor? Who knows? I'm not God. Melee strategy. While this boss is very difficult to predict, he does have a few signs for his attacks, and well-timed rolls are very important. Place yourself away from him by about twice his reach at all times, even for melee. Being able to fast roll is highly advised, but not necessary. Aerial attacks. When he uses his somersault slam attack, you will want to roll to the right as the camera tilts upward while locked onto him. You want to do this 3 times and then get in 1 or 2 attacks based on your weapon after the 3rd attack lands. Avoid attacking after his steadfast leap. Instead, use that opportunity to heal or get some distance from him. Standing attacks. When he uses his overhand smash, roll to the right. When he leaves himself open for a frame, he'll usually follow up with his spinning slash attack. Therefore, it is best to get some distance from him instead, as the spinning slash attack is difficult to get away from when it begins. Charging attacks. With his charging slash move, you will always want to roll backwards from where he intends to land the attack. After successfully dodging this attack, you will be able to get 1 or 2 hits on him. Ow! His heavy thrust attack will need to be side dodged. Depending on which way he turns during the charge, you will need to dodge the opposite way. After you dodge, he has a long recovery time, and you should be able to get 2 or 3 hits in. Other attacks. When you are behind Artorias, he may use his Abyss Sludge attack. This move does little damage, but can stun you. If timed right, you can roll forward through the attack and get a hit on him, then immediately retreat. After Artorias has lost 1/3 of his health, he will start to use his Wrath of the Abyss power-up. If left alone, he will do much more damage after he completes the power-up for a limited time, potentially one-shotting you. If you can get close enough, you can stun him out of his power before it's completed by hitting him repeatedly. If you don't do enough damage fast enough, he will then hit you with an Area of Effect blast attack that will knock you on your back. Your best bet is to use a heavy, high damage weapon and stop him from gaining his attack buff. Another safer way is to equip a bow in the offhand and shoot him repeatedly while he is charging up. Yet another way is to equip throwing knives and use those to stagger him in quick succession. I need water! Pocket sand. 1 shot, 1 kill. Ooh la la. Here's the trivia section. Artorias, like many characters, had unused content that was hidden between the game files. Here is the dialogue that was kept out of the final version. Artorias was supposed to have the same voice actor of Griggs of Vinheim. Oh my god! I have the hiccups again, because I'm really excited to hear this. I've never heard this before.
Opt. Stay away.
This is a Vaudi video video. Vaudi video video.
Soon.
Shout outs to Vaudi video.
Be consumed.
Oh my god.
By them. By the dog.
Oh no, his voice is hot. This is what I sound like after I eat at Chipotle.
Thou art strong, human. Surely thine kind are more than pure dark.
Oh my god.
I beg of the spread of the abyss.
The spread
must be stopped.
This sounds like me.
Sif, there you are. All of you, forgive me. For I have availed you nothing.
Oh no, that's sad. Oh! Jeez, calm down. Oh my god! Oh my god! This is so good. This is so good. Oh my god, this is the best. I just want him to be happy. I just want him to be happy and safe. Is that too much to ask for? I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be loud. I just got excited. Okay. Here's some more trivia about Artorias. Artorias with the good voice. It is speculated that Artorias had a romantic relationship with Lord's Blade Kirin before being corrupted by the Abyss. Artorias saved Seif from the spread of the Abyss using his Great Shield to construct a magical safeguard. However, Artorias' arm and shield were made vulnerable to the dark as a result. Great Grey Wolf Seif wields the Great Sword of Artorias in a fight against the Chosen Undead. All of Artorias' overhead attacks hit the player while on the ground or during roll animation, ignoring invincibility frames except for rolls with the Darkwood Green Ring. If the player dies to Artorias during the first fight, one can then hear him breathing while standing just outside the fog door. There's a lot of pictures of Artorias and they're all really cool. You look like a madman laughing right now. Thank you. The absolute
Were you
madman.
One of many Star Wars
oh my God.
Fans? Were-
I keep accidentally hitting the up button on my keyboard and it makes a video on the wiki page play. I'm really sorry about that. Keep forgetting. But yeah, all these Artorias pictures are really sweet and cool. Really nice and really cute. Big fan. Artorias. The best. The best Dark Soul? Possibly. Best Dark Soul Boy. 2018. Press F if you agree. Star Wars! Imagine Kylo Ren cleaning out your PC dust out of your PC tower because it got really dusty and you forgot to clean it. Thank you. Thank you very much. Artorias is terrifyingly cool and cute. And really nice. And really cute. One of the many Star Wars fans! I see a lot of Fs. Thank you, everyone. You all have great taste. I just dabbed. Cleaning out your tubes. Hello! I can't believe someone from Argentina is watching me. There's so many people from all over the world that watch me on YouTube and on Twitch. It's really amazing. Imagine Kylo Ren getting you another Awkwafina water bottle because you finished yours and there's only a little few droplets of water left inside. How long have I been doing this? I feel like I've been reading Dark Souls things for 2 hours? Oh god. Jeez. Well, I have to limit myself. If it were up to me, I would just do this until past midnight. Cause it's too much fun. I'll definitely do another one of these soon. Maybe my next one. My other idea I had was reading quotes from the Dark Knight Batman movie from the IMDb page for like an hour straight. I just thought it would be really goofy and fun. I like to have fun here. I love fun. Fun is good. I'm gonna eat some cereal. Cereal ASMR. This stream will be uploaded to my channel as a video automatically once it finishes, so don't you worry. Ow! Okay, if you don't like hearing people eat, I would suggest muting right now. I just got really hungry and I have to eat this cereal. You know how it is. You want to know where I got this cereal? I got it from Walmart. It's Kellogg's Special K Fruit and Yogurt. Naturally and artificially flavored. Crunchy rice and wheat flakes. With oat and fruit clusters and yogurt coated clusters. It's very good. Do you ever just eat dry cereal? You should try it. I will live stream Dark Souls on my Twitch channel. I have before. I'm going to stream the Dark Souls Remastered. The Dark Souls. Okay, I will read one more page. What Dark Souls page should I read? I'm taking suggestions. Munch, 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 crunch. It is nice cereal. Nice. When I click my tongue, it sounds really cool. Dr. Pepper, Dr. Pepper, Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper, Dr. Pepper, Dr. Pepper. Put it on nice, Dr. Pepper. Has anyone heard that song? Solaire, Black Iron Torquus, The Firekeeper. Ooh, I like that one. Firekeeper is my favorite Dark Souls 3 girl. Followed very, very, very closely by Carla. I love Carla. I like to, you know how she like sits in that little nook by the stairs in Firelink Shrine? I like to go over there and do the emote where your character like goes down on their hands and knees and puts their head down. And I do that so that my character's head goes into her lap. Like I'm resting my head in her lap. And I like to imagine that she's telling me about sorcery and stuff while I fall asleep. I'm really sad. Also, her voice is really good. Let's do Firekeeper. Firekeeper from Dark Souls 3. She's so good. Firekeeper. The Firekeeper is a character in Dark Souls 3. She is voiced by Oliva Mace. Description. The Firekeeper tends to Firelink Shrine and serves the Ashen One throughout their long and arduous journey. She allows them to level up an exchange of souls, much like the Emerald Herald from Dark Souls 2. She can also cure dark sigils the player has accumulated when provided with a Firekeeper soul. Location. The firekeeper can always be found tending the bonfire in Firelink's shrine. If she is killed by the player, she will always respawn at the same location. Lord. A blind maiden of unknown origin, she was, at the time, the current firekeeper that tended to the flame when the Ashen One arrived at the Firelink shrine to fulfill their duty. She dons a white crown that covers her eyes and a black robe. Like Shenalot, she could transform souls into raw power.
Raw power!
When given the eyes of the first firekeeper, she saw a world without fire and was frightened by the mere thought of it. Even so, she was willing to end the cycle permanently if the Ashen One requested it. If the Ashen One chose to realize their dream, she would be summoned to the kiln of the first flame. At that time, she would hold the first flame in her hands and let it die out. If the Ashen One chose to succumb to their desire, she would be killed during the ritual, and the power of the first flame would fall to their hands. If you kill her, shame on you. Imagine me looking you in the eyes with the most disdainful expression possible and saying, shame on you. Bad. Bad, bad, bad. Bad. Does Bruno Mars is gay? Services. Level Up allows the player to upgrade their stats individually in exchange for a determined amount of souls per level. Give. Available only if the Ashen One has acquired an item she can receive. Each item given will unlock a new service or event. Receivable items are the Firekeeper Soul.
Firekeeper Soul, woo!
And the Eyes of a Firekeeper. Heal the Dark Sigil. Option available only after giving her the Firekeeper Soul. The Firekeeper will then be able to remove dark sigils the Ashen One has accumulated throughout the course of the game, either by leveling up with Yule or by taking part on the ritual in Anor Londo. Additionally, she will also heal their hollowing level, thus restoring their physical appearance. The cost for healing each dark sigil is directly related to the player's soul level. Talk. Initiates her dialogue. Her available lines may change throughout the course of the game, depending on the player's action. She drops the eyes of a firekeeper, which very much look like blueberries. Thank you, Blake Bloodhound, for that super chat. Thank you. There's also dialogue, but there's probably a lot of dialogue. Oh my gosh, there's so much dialogue. Notes. Giving her the eyes of a firekeeper will allow her to unlock the End of Fire ending. If killed, she will always respawn at Firelink Shrine, stating that as a firekeeper, she cannot die. She will respond to most gestures performed by the player, and it's really cute. I love it. I love when you do a funny gesture and she laughs. It's so pure and so good. It cured my depression. Oh, whoa. Well, it's 8 o'clock, and I have to stop, or I'll be doing this for a very long time. I have to eat dinner, and I have to shower. Those are two very important life things that must happen. I should do a cover of Despacito when my throat is better. I have to learn how to actually sing the Spanish lyrics and not sound like a buffoon. What are those noises, by the way?
Actually, we need to unlock the phone first.
What the fuck? I think I activated my phone somehow. What is this?
Which one?
The Bixby. I didn't want you. That feels so cruel to say. How do I get out of this? I accidentally an entire Bixby. Oh, I activated it again. Oh no. Oh god. Oh no. Oh god. Oh no. Hey Bixby. Does Bruno Mars is gay? Here's what I found on the web. Okay, Google. Where is pee stored? That's not what I wanted. Urine is formed in the kidneys through a filtration of blood. The urine is then passed through the ureters to the bladder, where it is stored. During urination, the urine is passed from the balls through the urethra to the outside of the body. The more you know. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for attending my 2-hour long Dark Souls ASMR. Maybe I'll do another one soon. I don't know. It was really fun, though. I hope you all had a lot of fun. Thank you all for all of your support and your niceness. Had a fun time. I hope you're relaxed. Are you relaxed? Please be relaxed. So yeah, thank you for coming to my YouTube stream. I love you all, and I'll see you later. Probably with a new rap cover or another stream or something. And also, I plan on streaming E3 on my Twitch channel very soon. So if you want to watch E3 with me, you can come watch on my Twitch channel. I'm glad you're all relaxed. You're welcome. You're welcome. Alright. I'm going to leave now. I am sweaty and gay. Farewell.